Britain's blood pressure is going through the roof, and it's costing the NHS £2 billion a year.
High blood pressure is one of the most important factors, with others, that contributes to heart disease.
Part of the solution, eat less salt. But is this a battle we're prepared for?
How are we going to reduce it even more when everything has so much salt in it?
Tonight, Dispatches reveals the impact high salt diets are having on children.
It's very important in children to start early, not suddenly when you're 40 or 50, it's too late.
We ask how much salt we really need to enjoy our food.
We can reduce salt in bread and people don't notice the difference in taste.
And we find evidence suggesting the government's salt reduction plan has been influenced by food companies.
It is shocking that industry can have this level of influence over the targets.
Most of us know that we shouldn't have too much salt. But with a pinch here and a shake of a salad there, what do any of us really know about how much salt we eat every day?
I'm a busy working mum and I try my best to make sure my family's eating enough fruit and veg. I worry about how much fat and sugar we're all eating. But salt, well, it's not something I really tend to think about.
You might not think you use much salt, but chances are you do. 3/4 of the amount we eat is already in the food we buy.
We've looked at the salt content for hundreds of products, and it's startling how quickly it adds up, especially for children's food.
Take this typical kids' breakfast, a bowl of cornflakes with semi-skimmed milk, and a slice of toast with peanut butter. Add in lunch of a ham and cheese pack, specifically designed for kids' lunchboxes, and a classic packet of crisps.
If a child aged 6 or under had this breakfast and lunch with no extra snacks, they would have reached their maximum recommended daily intake of salt before they'd even started their dinner.
6 grams of salt, or about a teaspoon, is the most adults and children over 11 should have each day. For younger children, the recommendation is lower. The World Health Organization says that these amounts should be even less. So how much salt do we really need? I've come to see Professor Franco Cappuccio, a cardiologist and one of the world's leading experts on salt.
Salt is not a nutrient. It's a chemical added to our food and has entered our chain in evolutionary time pretty recently, a few thousand years ago. Our ancestors were eating absolutely no salt. And there's been clear studies in populations that when you eat salt, you have a much sharper rise in blood pressure as you get older.
What are the risks associated with high blood pressure?
High blood pressure is the most important factor that predicts your chance of getting a stroke, getting a kidney failure, and is one of the most important factors, with others, that contributes to heart disease.
So the health risks are considerable.
Indeed, they are. It's the day-to-day habit of being exposed every day to high salt over your lifetime that may create significant problems.
Just how dramatic are the effects of a high salt diet? Well, I'm going to find out by spending the next week eating double the recommended allowance. I'll record everything I eat and drink, my weight, and my blood pressure. And we'll reveal the results of the challenge at the end of the week. It's not just adults who should be concerned. Dispatches can reveal a disturbing pattern linking a high salt diet to high blood pressure in children as young as 12. We sent Freedom of Information requests to all NHS trusts across the country. From 29 responses, we calculated that in the last 10 years, the the number of children treated for high blood pressure has tripled. To get an idea of how much salt children are consuming, I've come to All Saints Primary School in North London. These pupils are going to help us take a snapshot of the amount of salt children eat every day.
Children, we are really, really lucky today because we've got our film crew who have come in, and Tazeen is here to speak to you all about your diet and all about the things that you eat every day, especially how much salt you eat. Okay? Tazeen.
Thank you. Who likes salt? Who doesn't like salt? Why do you like salt?
I like salt because it's that sort of yummy bit, and it's not like pepper.
That's a good answer. So, you've all agreed to take part in a test for us, haven't you?
Yeah!
So what we need you to do is we need you to collect all your wee for 24 hours. Can you do that for us? Does that sound yucky?
That would be great.
And then you're going to come and get them from us?
Yes, we are. And you're also going to keep a food diary for me. So what you're going to do is write down every single thing you ate and drank during that time you were collecting your wee, so that we know why you've got so much salt in your body or so little salt in your body. Does that make sense? Yeah? Great. Thank you very much for doing it.
The most accurate way of determining how much salt we eat is by measuring how much sodium is excreted in urine. The children's parents will supervise them, and we'll be back at the school for the results later on. Keeping tabs on how much salt you eat should be easy. All you have to do is take a quick look at the label.
We've all got a responsibility to make sure we know what we're putting in our shopping baskets, but is this as straightforward as it sounds? Well, not for the products we looked at. To be honest, a calculator would have come in handy. Big brands popular with children, and some clearly marketed for them, only gave percentage intakes for adults. Other labels only gave the amount of sodium the product contains. And we all know you need to multiply that by 2.5 to work out the salt equivalent, don't we? While not breaching any labelling regulations, this does show how difficult it can be to work out how much salt we're consuming. We also discovered that relying on the label might not even be enough. We sent 30 different products from different brands off to a lab to compare the amount of salt declared in the label with the amount that's actually in the products. At the time of testing, nearly two-thirds of them contained more salt than the label said. It might be surprising, but most of them were within the industry's acceptable margins of error. For salt, that can be up to 20% either side of the amount on the label. The results of three products stood out, and we tested a further 10 of each. 9 of the 11 packs of these Dairylea Lunchables ham and cheese crackers fell outside the tolerated margin of error. On average, they had around 30% more salt than declared. And at the time of testing, the salt content given on 10 out of 11 packets of these Valley Foods chicken fillets were also deemed not sufficiently accurate. One had over 60% more salt than it said on the label. The producers of Valley Foods chicken told dispatches,
"We have retested some of the same batches and found our results are different to yours and are legally compliant. We found no out-of-specification results. We have and are continuing to thoroughly investigate this issue as we take great care to ensure all of the products are legally compliant."
They added, after considering a wider sample, they will
amend this recipe to further reduce the added salt, which should ensure less possibility of any results falling outside legal limits.
And Mondelez International, which produces the Dairylea Lunchables, said,
"As a result of the issue raised by dispatches, we extensively checked the salt levels in Lunchables, which showed a proportion of packs were slightly above permitted tolerances. We therefore took steps to rectify this matter and can confirm all packs of Lunchables now on sale are within correct levels.
The final product we sent to the lab were these Heinz reduced salt baked beans. They're one of a number of products manufacturers offer that target our fear of salt. On average, the 11 tins we tested had 20% more salt than declared, but all were still within the tolerated margin of error. But 9 of the tins had too much salt in them to carry the reduced salt claim. One of the tins had almost as much salt as a regular tin of beans. We asked Heinz about their reduced salt beans. They said they
offer a significant reduction in salt versus our standard beans, which have also benefited from cuts to salt amounting to 50% over 10 years. Our nutrition information meets the criteria for claims based on calculated values using supplier information and standard data. The nutrition values of beans and tomato paste can vary from season to season and from growing region to region.
My week-long high salt binge has come to an end, thank goodness. The increased intake had a dramatic effect on my body, which I found surprising.
The results were very exciting and interesting.
Well, I tell you what, after I went from the low salt to the high salt diet, I really noticed the salt, really yes. Noticed. And then after a few days, barely noticed it at all.
Your taste buds will adapt. As you eat a lot of salt, you will need more salt to bring up the saltiness feel.
I felt dreadful.
Right.
I felt groggy, tired, bloated, uncomfortable, and I about sort of two-thirds of the way through, I just wanted to stop eating entirely.
One important thing is that high salt causes or improves thirst. Are you aware you drank more?
Oh, definitely. Because I don't drink large amounts normally.
On the last day, you drank about 30% more fluids, and you put on weight in the first 3 days, the amount of 3.2 kilos.
I know. I was really shocked.
And I think the feel of bloatedness bands have been there. 3.2 kilos is more than 10% of your body weight.
Yeah.
So this is how it works. Salt makes you thirsty. You drink more, so your body retains the extra fluid. It's this additional water that increases your weight. And that wasn't the only effect on my body.
Your blood pressure went up dramatically up to day 4. And then eventually, by the end of the experiment, your blood pressure settled to about 2 points higher blood pressures compared to your baseline. And that will stay forever as long as you stay on a high salt intake.
Most adults eat on average a third more salt than recommended every day. Could this be a habit some start in childhood? I'm back at the school with the results of our experiment.
But let me introduce you to Professor MacGregor.
With me is Professor Graham MacGregor, who campaigns to reduce our salt intake.
Thanks very much for doing the wee experiment and also for keeping your diaries as well. So, would you like to know the results of your experiment, your wee experiment? So, most of you are eating within the guidelines for the amount of salt you should be having for your age group. That's the good news. The bad news is that a third of you are eating more than the guidelines.
On average, the children within the guidelines were only just inside them. Another 0.5 gram and they'd have gone over. And 2 of the children had more than twice the recommended amount. The results of our experiment were consistent with similar national surveys. And new research for Dispatches shows how a higher salt intake can lead to higher blood pressure, even for children as young as 7.
The higher your blood pressure as a child, the more likely you are to go on to have high blood pressure later in life. So it's very important in children to start early, preventing the strokes and heart attacks should start from year 1, not suddenly when you're 40 or 50, it's too late.
Most of us associate high blood pressure with getting old, and only reduce our salt intake in middle age when the doctor tells us to.
It's never a thing to take your child to the doctors to have their blood pressure checked, especially when, you know, the majority, you know, they're all here, young, active, good weight, good, you know, you wouldn't do it.
We're not saying we should measure blood pressure in children, but if we want to have the maximum effect on preventing strokes and heart attacks, we should start early in children.
There's so much in the media about, you know, sugar, and sugar's the culprit, and you always think, okay, let's cut back on sugar, but we weren't that informed about salt.
It's quite scary because you try as a parent to give a healthy, balanced diet, and you think you are, and they're still having that much salt. You know, how are we going to reduce it even more when everything has so much salt in it? You're hitting your head against a brick wall.
Coming up, would we taste the difference if the amount of salt in our food was halved?
It all tastes the same. Sure. Definitely like.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we reveal evidence suggesting that government public health policy has been influenced by food companies.
Targets were watered down without any consultation with us. Where there was a change, it was all in the wrong direction.
Dispatches is investigating the amount of salt we eat, with claims it's as addictive as cigarettes. Cutting back on it may prove difficult, especially considering there's so much temptation around. Take these ready meals from Asda and Morrison's that contain more than half of an adult's recommended daily intake of salt. Eat half of this pizza, and again, you've had almost half of your daily amount of salt. But seriously, who only eats half a pizza? And one portion of this curry from Sainsbury's has the same amount of salt as in 13 packets of crisps. Being a bit naughty here and there does add up. The NHS is hemorrhaging cash dealing with illnesses linked to high blood pressure. This is despite a successful salt reduction campaign that ended in 2010.
We had a really good system with the Food Standards Agency, where we had a voluntary system, but they had the power to enforce other things, and the food industry responded very well to them, and the whole strategy was to slowly reduce the amount of salt in these products without making it very obvious. And as a result, salt intake was falling. We developed something that's we're leading the world, and then we give it up.
4 years ago, the coalition government scrapped the old policy and launched a new offensive in the battle to improve the nation's health.
Through the public health responsibility deal, the government will work with industry to help people make informed decisions about their diet and lifestyle, to improve the environment for health, and to make healthy choices easier.
The government's plan was to invite food companies to voluntarily sign up to a number of pledges to reduce things like calories and fat in their food. The salt reduction pledge was one of the first. However, Dispatches research suggests this strategy was flawed from the beginning. We can reveal that of the 73 companies that signed up to the pledge, just 12 have met all the targets they were supposed to achieve by 2012.
That's depressing. It's depressing because these were not what I would call stretch targets. These were not hard targets to meet, and to have not met those either really shows that there hasn't been enough enough initiative, enough impetus, or indeed enough to lose if you fail to meet the targets.
Undeterred, the Department of Health ploughed on. In 2013, a new set of targets was proposed and sent out to the food companies for comment. Dispatches obtained these documents under the Freedom of Information Act. It's the correspondence between the Department of Health and food companies at the time of the consultation. The documents reveal industry reluctance to agree to the proposed new targets. Some cited technical reasons, as salt can be used as a preservative in some food. Others said it didn't make commercial sense, as competitors hadn't even met the old targets. But the reason for opposing the targets given by half targets. The Department of Health eventually revised their proposals against the advice of the health lobby.
We went through with the Department of Health officials all the targets, working out what we thought was reasonable, but we were then incredibly surprised that targets were watered down without any consultation with us. Where there was a change, it was all in the wrong direction. There were none that were made tougher, in spite of the fact we said many of them should be.
Our analysis shows that 17 of the salt reduction targets ended up being weaker than those originally proposed by the Department of Health.
It is shocking that industry can have this level of influence over the targets. Like anyone setting their own homework, you don't set something which is going to be very difficult to achieve, and government must set targets. They can then start to explore with industry how industry will meet those targets, but the targets should not be up for negotiation.
What's the alternative?
What government must do, and it's an absolute must, is to sit down and say, this is what we are going to achieve. If you don't do what's needed, we will regulate or legislate and make you do it.
Following the election, the government has pledged to continue with the responsibility deal as a means to encourage food companies to lower salt in their products. So is taste a barrier to lower salt levels in food, as some of the big manufacturers say it is? Would we notice if it wasn't there?
Hello, welcome to our bread palace.
Of all the food we eat, we get most salt from bread. So we asked members of the public to taste five loaves at random, each with a different amount of salt, from standard levels to none at all. They'll mark on a chart how much they like or dislike each one, but we're not telling them the test is about salt.
Hello, hi. Thanks for taking part in our test.
From definitely dislike to definitely like, just put a mark anywhere on that scale.
That's like, that's dislike.
That's right. Okay.
Helping us is Dr. Kamal Mehtani from Oxford University's Centre for Evidence-Based Medicine.
I think I'll put that one on this side.
Sure.
Definitely like.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. You don't like that one?
Okay.
I just expect it might be the same bread all along.
You're not impressed with our bread, are you?
I can't taste a lot of difference between those.
Do you like a slightly more, or is it the same?
Same.
No, about the same.
Okay.
It tastes the same. It all tastes the same.
So you preferred bread made with normal levels of salt, but your next favourite was bread number one.
Yeah.
Which actually had 50% less salt than bread number two. And actually, you were very close in your scores.
I like salt. So everything I eat has a lot of salt on it, but I couldn't tell.
I am surprised, yeah. Especially with the fact that I prefer the one with the 50% less salt, because I normally love salt.
Half the people we challenged couldn't tell the difference between the high and low salt breads. This reflected the results of Dr. Mehtani's much wider scientific study of over 300 participants.
As health professionals, we're trying to reduce the nation's salt. One of the barriers, potential barriers anyway, was whether it might impact on taste. So we thought, let's test the theory. So what we found was that the bread made with standard levels of salt scored the highest in our taste test. But the bread made with 50% less salt scored the next highest, and the margin was close enough for us to conclude there was no statistical significance between the two scores.
So essentially, people couldn't tell the difference.
Yeah, so what our results show is that we can reduce the amount of salt in bread without impacting on taste. That can have massive effects, not just at an individual level, but at a population level. What we've demonstrated here is that we can reduce salt in bread and people don't notice the difference in taste. Now, there's no reason why that science can't be applied to other food items, often high in salt content.
We wanted to speak to the Department of Health about this and other issues about the responsibility deal. In a statement to dispatches, the public health minister said,
"We have worked with industry to reformulate popular products, challenging them to be creative and innovative, in order to help the public eat less salt and make healthier choices. By working in partnership with industry, the UK has reduced average daily salt intakes by 15% between 2000 and 2011. We know that reducing daily intakes by just 1 gram has the potential to prevent almost 5,000 premature deaths a year and save an annual £288 million for the health service.
We all have to keep an eye on how much salt we eat to help avoid serious health problems later in life. To do this, we need to trust the accuracy of food labels and rely on government to ensure the food industry uses the least amount of salt possible in their products. Our investigation shows we're a long way off both.